I'll tell you, you did a hard job I've had today trying to contain them knowing that you were coming in.
Yeah, I bet.
That I'll tell you. I know you're busy. But look, because Keith was on, of course, at the beginning of the programme talking about his broken leg, you've had two broken legs, what, in the last how many months?
Within the last year, really. I re-broke again the same place in March.
In March of this year?
Yeah. Yeah.
I find it amazing that after breaking it twice that you're actually back playing at all.
I was lucky. I had a lot of support from the manager, to be honest with you. He was very good to me. I mean, I re-broke it for the second time and he rung me a day or so later and said, get yourself right and there'll be a contract here for you. And I was approaching 38 years old, so when you've got someone behind you like that, it certainly helps, you know. But
yeah, but I mean, it's one thing to have the manager behind you, whatever. Nevertheless, it's just getting the leg back and mended and working enough to go back on the pitch.
Yeah, it was. I was lucky, really, in some respects. It was quite a straight break, you know. It was just the shin, well, I say, just the shin bone. So it wasn't both bones in the leg itself. And it was a very straight break, so much so that they x-rayed it at the ground, said it was quite straight, put me in a sort of ski boot and sent me home in a car, you know. So it was quite a low-key break, really, you know.
No and nonsense. Then you had to pick up on it all later on.
Yeah, we had this deja vu again. Obviously, when it first went again, or re-broke, I thought, well, this is it, you know. And then sort of I had the support from sort of Harry and one or two people around me said, well, if you do the rehabilitation, whether you come back or not, at least you'd be fully fit to retire or take your options from there. And as luck happens, I've not really felt too much problems with it, touch wood.
Touch wood, exactly. So you're back on the pitch now for about a month.
Yeah, I've done two and a half pre-season matches and the first three matches in the Premiership, so it's all gone reasonably well, apart from results for us at the moment.
The team not doing that well.
Yeah, apart from that.
Now, 78 caps, though, for England, which is an amazing record, and they're playing France in France this weekend.
Yeah.
Did you hope that maybe, just maybe, you might get out on that team this weekend?
I think everyone that sort of it means a great deal to represent their country in whatever sport they do always keeps one eye on the teletext just to see whether their name's mentioned in a squad, you know. I've retired on two or three occasions from the international fold and been brought back by one or two managers, so I'd never rule anything out at the moment, but I'm obviously, with the recent history with the legs and stuff, I'm just pleased to be playing at West Ham, to be honest.
But a lot of injuries in the English team at the moment. Are you travelling to France anyway, just in case?
No, what happened was I had a phone call from Kevin last week, Kevin Keegan, and he said, did I want to pop along? And he involves me, even though I've not been fit last year, which is quite a bonus, I think, more so because they're a card player short rather than I could possibly play, you know. But he brings me along and just, you know, says, please yourself, come and get involved. It's good to have you about. And I've been with the squad for the last 2 days of this week, so I've quite enjoyed that. But obviously other commitments at the moment, football at West Ham, I've sort of not going to France with the team.
As a matter of interest, I mean, how unusual is it for a 38-year-old still to be playing First Division football?
I think if you take the goalkeepers out of the equation, there's probably, I think, maybe Richard Gough. I think he's either 37 or 38, and Dave Watson at Everton. So there's two or three of us. I don't think there's any more off the top of my head.
So what is it then that just drives you, that you say, I just want to keep on playing First Division? I mean, is it just a total, total passion for the whole game?
Yeah, I there's no doubt about it. I love the job I do. In a silly way, I mean, I sort of didn't come into football until I was 21 years old. So I was an electrician and worked in a warehouse for a year. So I've got it in my head somewhere that it owes me 5 years. So I'm going to try and hang out till I'm about 40, you know. And that sort of keeps me going a little
bit. Good for you. Well, actually, of course, we saw the great goal as such in 1996.
96, yeah.
But we have to go back to 1990. For that terrible minute. Do you find it frustrating, of course, that, you know, as a great football player, that people keep bringing up the penalties?
It's probably a big part, you know. It's what I'm sort of renowned for, really, at the moment. The miss, first off, and then, obviously, 6 years later, that they were both sort of occasions in big tournaments, you know, semi-finals in big tournaments. I think so, in some ways it probably made me a little bit stronger, you know, mentally, missing that one in 1990.
Awful feeling.
Yeah, I think at the time, I mean, there's been a lot of sort of penalty shootouts in football probably since then. But at the time it was quite a new phenomenon, really, finishing matches on penalties. And weren't the best way, you know.
No, I mean, because you're a very patriotic type of person. So, I mean, is the feeling at that time I've just let the whole country down, basically?
Yeah, I remember walking back and, you know, by the time you get to a semi-final in a tournament, there is a very close-knit squad situation amongst you with the management, the players. You're all very close together. You've been together for 6 or 7 weeks at that stage. I remember walking back, you think, oh, Christ, when I get back to England, I'm going to get lynched. I remember thinking my parents and my girlfriend, wife now, were in the crowd and you feel as though you've let them down, as well as your teammates, basically. It was... people ask me whether sort of I would go up and take the penalty again knowing I would miss, and I've always said that I'd rather do that than let a teammate go up and miss.
And your wife's always saying, why do you put yourself up to do it all the time?
Yeah, she's a big believer in other idiot do it, you know what I mean? But probably for that fact, again, that I think, you know, I couldn't stand on an halfway line and let five other of my teammates go up. Whether I'm stupid or not, I don't know, but I think that I can take a reasonable penalty. Obviously, that disproves that statement, but I think that I'm a reasonable penalty taker, so I think I'd rather do it than let someone else do it for me.
You like the edge and the fear, I think.
Possibly, yeah.
But actually, we obviously saw your wife, and I know she's very supportive, and in the book you talk greatly about your dad. I mean, he's been just so supportive right throughout your career. So he must be so proud of you by this stage.
Yeah, as I say, you know, my dad's well into his 80s now. He's still, you know, with it, let's say, you know. But he's come to watch me, and my mother did as well, and took me to matches, district games, school matches. He used to come and watch a lot of football. And it's probably the support that I had there. And then when I went into the professional game...
He was feeling terrible about having missed a penalty. So.
I know. To be honest with you, he rung me. Well, we rung him and said, have you been approached by Pizza Hut? And they said, he said, yeah. He said, what do you think? I said, yeah, I think you should do it, mate. You know, people won't mind. People don't care. It's old hat now. And he went, yeah, you're right. And then I rung Chris Waddle. I went, Gareth's doing it. Is he stupid or what?
Unless we want to be in the next programme, I have to say, they think it's all over. It is now. See you tomorrow at 2:15. Thanks. Thank you very much.